Guns go missing from the police station, and tonight police have questions for one of their own. And Chester walks the line, the borderline. We'll go to Arenal with the police chief, plus a 25-year-old on a motorbike killed in a terrible traffic accident in Orange Walk. Also, finally, two more fire trucks for San Pedro. We've got details of these and other stories in our newscast for tonight, Thursday, December 12, 2019. Good evening. With your news, I'm Indira Craig.
Christmas is that time of the year when we spread that holiday cheer with our family and friends far and near. This season, make more calls, send more texts, share all your Christmas experiences, because the more you share, the more chances you have to win in Digi's Grand Christmas Raffle, where the grand prize is an amazing 2020 Wingle 7. Pick up that Christmas device from Digi or sign up for DigiNet and you also qualify. Postpaid customers, you too can spread that Christmas cheer and win. Just ensure that your bill is paid up. With over $60,000 in cash and prizes, there's so many reasons for you to share that Christmas feeling with everyone. The more you share, the more chances you have to win. Drawing date December 24 at 3 p.m. This season, share all the joy with Digi and win.
The Honorable Edmond clear the land and off the air, and thank you, Bash. And this time we come in to Sand Hill on Sunday, December 29th.
Musical entertainment by Boots the Titty Man Flores, Harrison Doggy King, Continental Cat,
Punta Queen with her dancers,
Youth Connection Band,
The Singing Policeman, and Ozzy the Clown,
DJs Baba, Rustingi, and DJ Malcolm. Free food, clear the land style, free buses leaving in all villages in Belize Rural North. Just get in touch with your village leaders for transportation information. The party ends with big fireworks, clear the land style. A big thank you from your era representative for Belize Rural North, Honorable Edmond Clear the Land Castro.
It's the Honorable Edmond Clear the Land and off the air, and thank you, Bash. And this time we come in to Sand Hill on Sunday, December 29th.
Let's get to
Original improved Duracell with a new look and packaging. When you think dependability, when you think long lasting, when you think power, there is only one name that matters. That name is Duracell, the world's longest lasting battery. With authentic Duralock Preserve technology. Original product, original quality, with a new look and packaging. Authentic, dependable, and longer lasting Duracell. Distributed by Price Premier Products Limited, importers and wholesalers of fine quality products.
Poor people, the outer the struggle. This government, the play last. This man, the eat steak every day. He no business. Beauty and price low, and they vex. They know our poor people come up.
If these importers / distributors / retailers can bring down the price of beauty and to this low, it means they could have been doing it for many, many years. It means that the ordinary people of this country, all of us, have been fleeced, have been shafted. We know you're not the business of being shafted, you know. You understand? And you can't tell me because that that's how new people want to shaft you, that the locals want to shaft you, that no foreigners want to shaft you. I don't care who, I don't want nobody shaft me.
UDP, the lone fat cat, left the poor people there to live this Christmas, left the beauty and price loan. We're tired of you. We're tired of the UDP.
Smart's broadband got even better. You can now bundle and get a free monthly prepaid mobile plan with your broadband service and enjoy up to $70 in savings. Or you can upgrade your mobile plan for an additional $25 and enjoy an unlimited postpaid plan with unlimited calls, texts, and $40 free data. With Smart's fast internet speeds, you just have to choose the speed that works for your needs. Don't wait. Visit the Smart showroom near you and sign up for your broadband plus mobile bundle. And why not? Sign up and add Netflix to the mix. Smart, your full-service communication company.
Your Christmas bright with an easy credit loan from Atlantic Bank. Apply today and enjoy low interest rates, convenient repayment terms, and make no principal payments up to 2 months. With every approved loan, get a chance to win one of our 12 fantastic prizes. For more details, visit atlabank.com. Atlantic Bank, making your holidays brighter.
What is Bunny thinking about right now? Nothing. Because there's a new Duracell battery. It now lasts even longer. So now you can think even less about batteries. And so can Duracell Bunny. Duracell lasts longer, much longer.
Distributed by Price Premier Products Limited, importers and wholesalers of fine quality products.
As one of the largest cable and internet providers in Belize, CBC strives to provide our customers with the highest standards of quality, value, and service in all aspects of cable TV and internet. Monitoring our systems closely, our technicians combine creative planning and state-of-the-art technology with years of experience and training to develop and provide the most reliable and advanced cable and internet service to exceed your expectations. For CBC and our team of talented engineers, technicians, and customer service representatives, delivering less than the very best is never an option.
Tonight, police are looking for one of their own, reportedly after a few guns went missing from the Precinct 3 station. 22-year-old Police Constable Nadir Mendoza from Santa Elena Town is the subject of a wanted poster that went out this morning. According to reports, he is a person of interest in relation to at least two guns which went missing from the Queen Street station. The guns went missing over the weekend, and initial reports are that the constable was detained. But he somehow escaped, and that's why he is the subject, on a wanted poster tonight. It may be one of the first wanted posters we've seen for a police officer. As the poster says, if you have any information, please contact your local police station or make a report online at belizepolice.bz. For the past 2 weeks, we've been reporting on carjackings in the West, led mostly by cross-border bandits pressing into border communities. Well, police hope to put a stop to it. This morning, a convoy of police and BDF left Benques Police Station and headed down the Arenal Road. Cherise Halsal traveled to Benque and beyond to see what the cops are doing to thwart transnational crime.
It's been an intense 3 weeks for the people of Benque, Sokot, and the surrounding areas. On December 5th, the body of a missing former schoolteacher, Elito Puk, was discovered decapitated in the adjacency zone. And in the last 3 weeks, there have been a string of 5 carjackings on the Hydro Road in the Pine Ridge area. Officer Commanding Superintendent Diana Hall says the vehicles have likely been chopped up for parts in Guatemala.
The Benque Fijo Formation has seen 5 reported incidents where vehicles, four vehicles and one motorcycle was stolen in the Sokots area. 2, a motorcycle and a pickup, and on the Arenal Road we had 3 pickups that were stolen. One at 10.5 miles on the Hydro Road, one at 1.5 miles on the Hydro Road, and 3.5 miles on the Hydro Road. Well, the first 2 incidents, 2 masked men with shotguns, and the other 3 incidents were 3 Hispanic male persons with short arms.
Is it believed that these men are linked to each other?
We do believe so.
Is it believed also that they're coming across from the border?
Yes, we have information that it's 2 Guatemalan and a Belizean. The information that we receive is that these culprits take the vehicles over to the Guatemala side to a chop shop. They would come into our neighborhood, take photograph of the vehicle, the target that they want, and then they would just react.
And there were also similarities in the way that the men were disguised when they did this, correct?
Yes. They had combat, some might be in farm clothes, and they also had the weapons, and they knew the people because they called them by name, so they might be familiar to the area.
In an effort to combat the outlaw behavior in what has been one of the country's most peaceful areas, Commissioner of Police Chester Williams today led a convoy of police officers on a familiarization tour of back roads leading to the Guatemalan border. And it was a very involved tour. The compo consulted with the mayor of Benque, checked in on the checkpoint at the entrance to the Arenal Road, and stopped in at the police station at the end of the world, or at least the end of Belize.
Today what we did was to go and look at the different areas, and as you can see, in the Arenal area, those areas that were easily accessible to the bandits who comes over have now been blocked with fallen trees, and we intend to, by the end of the day today, dig some trenches across those roads to prevent the bandits from coming over so easily through with the use of vehicles. And the same you can see in the Sokots area, the road that link Sokots to the Benque area, that too has been cut off, because that was a back road used by the bandits. When they take the vehicles, they go from Sokots into Benque and then through the Arenal Road. And so what we're looking at is to see how we can cut off all access to those persons.
But once the commissioner and the cameras that came with him leave, operations here will move forward with what ACP Vidal calls a 3-pronged strategy.
Given these incidents recently, we have looked at a 3-pronged approach, right, to this issue. One, we have looked at intelligence. We're looking at our patrol strategy. And we are looking at the issue of incorporating neighborhood watch programs and adding that community policing aspect to it in this area so we can get more support from the community and getting this community to assist us in terms of moving forward with our strategy. In terms of intelligence, we have been coordinating from pretty much from its inception with the National Police of Guatemala. We intend to go even further than that, to go to the Ministry of Ministerio de Seguridad Pública, which would be the head office in Petén, to get other more investigative officers involved from their end to do certain things that we want to get done from their side in terms of recovery of the vehicle, etc. In terms of the patrol, they will be responsible also for the patrol at the immediate environs of Sokots village. Our efforts have been bolstered with the BDF now, so we are looking at the BDF extending this operation along with the police to cover the outskirts of Sokots.
Commissioner Williams says that the recent crime spree may be a result of the opportunity that had been created by an area that, in terms of police presence, was undermanned.
One of the issues the people of Sokots were complaining about was the fact that the police station here in Sokots was not being manned, or was undermanned, and I fully agree. Sokots have expanded significantly, and so we need to ensure that we step up our level of policing by increasing our numbers to be able to meet the demands of the community. And so I have directed Ms. Hall that I want by tomorrow we have 4 police officers posted in Sokots instead of 1. And by the end of next week, we'll have a 5th officer.
And while the trenches are meant to stop any more criminal encroachments, police remain aware that the community also faces threats from internal criminal activity.
Whatever it is that we're doing on the outskirts will form as a defense doom to the Benque Arenal area, with a view to see how we can keep out the bandits. And we don't only want to focus on international bandits. We also want to focus on those that we have within our country. So we have to look at both transient and cross-border criminals.
Reporting for 7 News, this is Charisse Halsall.
In February of 2020, when another set of recruits pass out of the police academy, 4 of them will be assigned to Sokuts, allowing for patrols to be carried out without reinforcements from Benke. And what police are battling in Arinal, they are also fighting in Sokuts. The bandits have been operating between the two western villages and the town of Benke Viejo. As we told you last night, Sokuts residents organized and armed themselves to expel bandits from their area. Now, some feedback accounts portrayed this in an exaggerated narrative with clear racist undertones. Compo Williams said he lent that no credence but underscored his support of that kind of concerted community action.
I am not going to condemn the good people of Sokuts. I believe that after we communicated with them, they have decided to work with us. At the meeting last night, they were very receptive, they were very open, and I can't say nothing negative about them. Yes, the people were concerned, and they decided that they are going to do what they can to protect their community, and I welcome that. And I wish that we'll have more communities like Sokuts, where when people see criminality, they decide to stand together and fight against criminality. And then what we, the police, need to do now is to stand with them.
Williams had a lively meeting with Sokuts villagers last night. Compo Williams also commented on the story that's been much in the news recently. It's a case of the police officer seen choking Anthony Tillett. Williams says he's seen the video and action has been taken.
Yes, I did see that video, and I will say it is very disturbing, and I have given instructions to professionals and advanced to move expeditiously with that matter. I know the officer has been placed on disciplinary charge and will be interdicted from duty. The virtual complainant, Mr. Tillett, do not wish to proceed with criminal charges against the officer, so we'll only proceed internally against him. And whenever that matter is disposed of by the tribunal, then we'll see where it goes from there. It doesn't serve us any well to condone the illegal or ill-disciplined act of our officers. If we condone it, then the entire department is worth nothing. We believe in doing what needs to be done to maintain the integrity of our department. As a department, we try as best as we can to work with the public. And we cannot be seen to be abusing or beating the public that we are asking to work with us. And so whenever our officers step out of line, then it is our duty to ensure that they are dealt with. If you can see the case with Sergeant Walton with Nestor Vasquez, that was done within a quite reasonable time. And even though some may say that it has to do with the person involved, that is not so, because there are several other cases that have been dealt with in more expeditious manner, but they were not of public interest, and so they were not out there. The one that Mr. Vasquez was of public interest, and so that was out there in the media, so everyone captures that. But it is what we do.
And another non-police oversight body has also been reviewing the case. This morning, the rarely heard from Civilian Complaint Review Committee posted on its Facebook page that it yesterday reviewed complaints against the police for November 2019. They looked at complaints from Jordy Usher of Georgeville and the video of Anthony Tillett being assaulted. For the Jordy Usher complaint, the firearm and ammunition that was the arresting officer had in his possession have been submitted for ballistic forensic analysis. In Anthony Tillett's case, he has made a written statement to the Professional Standards Branch, which is now under review. And we take a break now. When we come back, we'll tell you about a fiery, fatal traffic accident this morning in the north. Don't go away.
Customers, this is your chance to win big with Smart and Quartz Mega Raffle 2019. Starting November 6th through December 23rd, for every $5 you use on calls, texts, data, and roaming bundles for the week, you get one raffle entry to win weekly amazing prizes.
Or you can purchase a chance for just $1 by sending an SMS to YOUWIN 8946.
On November 11th, you can win a one-night stay for two at San Ignacio Hotel, $100 certificate from Pink's Boutique, $500 cash from Innovative Signs, and a power washer from Brother Sabet.
Then on November 18th, win a one-night stay for two at Hopkins Bay Resort. Round-trip tickets for two from My Island Air, plus $200 cash from Smart.
on November 25th, win a one-night stay for two at Sunbreeze Hotel. Round-trip tickets for two from Tropicair, plus a mega basket from Grace Kennedy.
On December 2nd, win a one-night stay for two at Shaw Creek, a family photo shoot with Night and Day, plus dinner for two at Bird's Eye.
Then, on December 9th, win a round-trip ticket from United Airlines, plus a $1,000 savings account from Belize Bank.
And on December 16th, you can win an iPhone 11 Plus, round-trip tickets for four courtesy San Pedro Belize Express.
This mega raffle giveaway doesn't end there. On December 23rd, one lucky winner gets to walk away with a mega gift. $10,000 in furniture and appliances, courtesy of Quartz and Smart, just in time for the Christmas. So every Monday, you could be a lucky winner with Smart.
60 seconds. Benny's in 60 seconds.
Hey, Belize. Benny's Deal Alert season is here, and we have some great deals for you.
Deals, deals, and more deals. From now up until December 31st, enjoy Deal Alert discounts on our line of paints, such as BH paints, Texture Light paints, and Tropical Colors paints. Deal Alert markdowns will also be applied on a wide selection of tiles, lights and fans, tools, appliances, and much more.
And remember, whenever you make a purchase, you get double tickets to enter our cash giveaway draw on December 21st to win $10,000.
That's right. It's a Deal Alert. It's a Venice Deal Alert. So shop now, get great deals and your tickets for the chance to win the $10,000 grand prize only at Benny's.
Benny's in 60 seconds.
Take a journey with us to endless possibilities. Our future as a country is now. DigiNet Boost is countrywide. Taking Belize into the future. A nationwide technological evolution. As the most advanced fiber connection, DigiNet Boost is a step forward into a modern world. Belize is powered by DigiNet. DigiNet Boost, now available countrywide.
Distributed by Price Premier Products Limited, importers and wholesalers of fine quality products.
Extended one more day. Get your Christmas apples at West Track Service Station in Belize City. Golden Glory, Red Delicious, and Gala. It's almost gone. Call 614-5541. Pick up Friday, December 13th, West Track Service Station. Support Belize Changing Belize.
Caribbean, your number one hit music station.
Wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year from Quail's Distillery Limited.
It's Christmas time, Belize. And at Brothers Habet, we have deals and much more in the store, you bet. Power tools, tiles, and Nouveau light fixtures. 15% off and $10 grout, mister. And at Brothers Habet, it's that time of year where the colors of the rainbow are ours to share. Yes, Berger, Dutch Boy, Domestic, and Penta. All month discounted by 15%. Plus, our 12 Days of Christmas giveaway event and the giveaway every Saturday. So come in and spend. And if that not enough, we got enough price drops, specials and clearance up to 60%, pops. So come to Brother Sabek, cause we want to see you soon to wish a Merry Christmas from all of we to you.
Make your holiday season bright with free installation, free reconnection, and 6 months free Debo 3. Experience the magic of the season and reconnect to your loved ones with our fast and reliable internet speeds. Enjoy more family time with on-demand access to all the latest movies, original series, and catch live sporting events in high definition on TNT 10. From our next-gen family to yours, we wish you a peaceful, joyous, and prosperous holiday season. Next Gen, powered by Central TV and Internet.
A man on a motorcycle lost his life early this morning on the Trinidad August Pine Ridge Road in the Orange Walk District. He's 25-year-old Leonardo Velasquez, and he crashed head-on into a trailer that was attached to a tractor. At today's police press briefing, the deputy head of the National Criminal Investigations Branch discussed the deadly accident.
On Thursday, the 12th day of December 2019, around 5:30 a.m., there was a fatal road traffic accident on the Trinidad August Pine Ridge Road in Orange Walk. Investigation revealed that Leonardo Velasquez, 25 years, was riding his motorcycle on the road when he collided into a trailer that was attached to a tractor. He fell off the motorcycle and received severe head and body injuries and was taken to the hospital where he was pronounced dead on arrival. Investigation is being conducted into this matter to determine if anyone is at fault or if any charges will be levied on anyone.
So is there any indications as to factors that could have caused this accident?
The investigation is ongoing. At some point he was coming from the opposite direction and collided into the trailer.
But there was one significant factor that did contribute to the accident, and that is fog. An eyewitness told CTV3 that at 5 this morning, the fog caused limited visibility. Ronald Castaneda's father was driving the tractor, and he was on the trailer behind it.
We came early this morning, and the mist was thick and heavy. It was like about 5 in the morning, and we came illuminating the area with our headlights. And a tractor also had its lights to see the road, but the mist was very strong. My dad was driving and I was coming in the trailer with the workers, and we stopped to enter, but we did not see any lights that were coming. And my dad tried to enter to go to the cane field, and the motorcycle crashed into the tractor, and then unfortunately the man died. My dad is in the hospital, he broke his leg. His right foot is broken, and because of the impact, he was thrown off the tractor and fell on the pavement on the road, and we tried to put out the fire because it was an explosion. The motorcycle exploded.
The exploding motorcycle likely had little effect on Leonardo Velasquez, who is believed to have died on impact. According to the 25-year-old's mother, his last night alive was a happy one because his team had just won a football match.
We've heard that he was riding and a tractor was coming from the same direction that he was headed in. And it seems that he didn't manage to see it, and that's how the accident came about. And that's where he died. Did he walk this road a lot? Yes, because he would go on Monday, come back on Wednesday, and then leave again on Thursday. But he never went on his motorcycle. He always took the bus at 4:30 to go. But today, I don't know what happened, but he was going on his motorcycle. Did he work in Orange Walk? In Belize, in Medina's Construction. That's where he worked. That's why he had to leave early to arrive in time. You were telling us that he was a person who loved to play football. Yes, he was on a team there in August Pine Ridge. Last night he played his last match with them, and he posted that he was happy because they won. He was a very fun person when he was with family. He came and ran jokes. He loved playing and everything with everyone. It's been more than 8 days since I saw him due to his job. He hadn't come in a while, only once in a while when it had already been more than 15 days. Then he would come for a little while and he would leave. He has a 5-year-old son. His name is Andre Velasquez.
Sí, tiene un niño de 5 años. Se llama Andre Velasquez.
No word yet on whether the tractor driver Feliciano Castaneda will be charged. As you heard, he too had to be hospitalized. So while the cops are trying to decide if they will bring charges for this morning's fatal accident, they continue to look for suspects for Monday afternoon's aggravated burglary in the Belama Phase 1 area of Belize City. As we reported, two females, a 22-year-old housekeeper and a 17-year-old minor, were at a home on Samuel Haynes Street when armed burglars broke in and tied them up. They also robbed a male employee on the way out. What they didn't count on was that a vigilant neighbor was armed and he opened fire on them as they tried to escape. They fired two shots back, dropped a suitcase full of stolen liquor in the process. Police told us today that they believe the robbers came across the river.
Police, as a result, conducted an investigation and they conducted a search across the river that leads to the Martins area, where they recovered some liquor and other small items that were reported in that burglary.
Is it believed that the perpetrators of this crime used the river as a way to transit to where the victims were asleep?
Yes, we do believe that they used the river to come from the side of the Martins area into the Belama area and they went back the same way.
So is there any suggestion that maybe these culprits had prior information that valuables were at this house?
That is something that we are looking at, information that we had received earlier, and that we are working on that likewise.
Was there any shots fired, sir, from some vigilant neighbor?
Yes, we were told that whilst the guards were fleeing, a person that was on the nearby area fired a shot at them.
In 1 week time, there was like two aggravated burglary on the same street. Is it believed that these two incidents are connected?
Yes, it occurred on the same Samuel Haynes Street, but at different residence. We believe that it is people from the other side of the river that are targeting these houses.
First threatened one of his victims, telling her he had killed many times before. The string of Christmas holiday crimes continued yesterday in Belize City. A delivery man from Big H and his helpers were robbed of over $1,000 in company cash while they were on the job. Police told us this morning that the attackers pounced while the delivery man was making a sale to a grocery shop on LaCroix Boulevard.
Yesterday at about 11:20, a delivery truck belonging to Big H were doing a delivery in LaCroix Boulevard when they were held up by two male persons who came on board of a motorcycle. The driver and two other assistants to the driver were held up, and stolen from them was about $1,000 in cash and cell phones. Thereafter, the person made good their escape in the area.
No one has been arrested for this incident as yet. Tonight, both Desmore Bowman and Tariq Devon Lopez remains on the missing persons list. They are among a host of persons reported missing in recent weeks. Also among those were 18-year-old Michael Kobo and 42-year-old Elito Puk, those men, were found dead and terribly mutilated. Indeed, it's getting to the point that the public presumes the missing to be dead within a week. He spoke to Commissioner of Police Chester Williams today after his Arenal Road tour to ask him about police strategies to locate missing persons. He told us that people are dying senselessly because they refuse to inform police of threats to their lives.
Yes, we know we have a number of persons who have gone missing, and in some cases, some of them were found murdered, and we have some who were found alive and well. You all know that there is always ongoing feuds between rivaling groups, maybe gangs, or in some cases not gang, but persons who have issue with each other, and that may result in persons being kidnapped, taken somewhere and killed. And these are things that we need to look after. But one of the most salient thing that we found in these investigations is the fact that the persons, when they do go missing, the family would then say to us that they were being threatened for some time, but nothing was said to the police. No one comes to the police. So we are never aware of the fact that these persons were being threatened until when they disappeared and are found dead. And so we want to appeal to the public that if it is that you are being threatened by anybody, do not take the threats lightly. Come to the police, report it to us. Even if you don't want any court action, you can make a future reference report, and with that, we'll be able to approach the person or persons who are threatening you and try to see what we can do to intervene to prevent anything from going further. Keeping it to yourselves and do not report it to the police, then when you're kidnapped and found dead, then the police is blamed, it makes no sense. We cannot deal with something if we know nothing about it. But if we know about it, then we can do something to see what we can do to prevent it from going any further.
Also still on the missing persons list are the fishermen who headed out to Mapki. The family of 36-year-old Jasmine Garcia finally got the results of the post-mortem examination today. It found that Garcia received head trauma from multiple stab wounds. The family also says Garcia was not sexually assaulted. As we reported, Garcia was killed and her body dumped in the sea in Dangriga. Her body was found in underwear on the seashore near the pier early Sunday morning. Police are still working on establishing a clear motive and suspects. Her family says she had been receiving threats. Oceana, Will Mejia and NGO Senator Osmani Salas have spoken out against the government's position on gill nets because it is not the full ban that conservationists were expecting. Well, the Belize Federation of Fishers just joined the chorus, stating, quote, most fishers are of the view that the proposed changes do not go far enough and that the enforcement measures being taken will not be effective. We feel that a total ban is needed. It continues by saying, quote, more than a dozen gillnet fishers have indicated to the BFF that they are prepared to immediately give up their nets, providing that alternatives are made available. The release adds, quote, our fishers see in this issue a serious threat to national security because most gillnet users in the south are Guatemalan and Honduran fishermen who move back and forth across our maritime borders unimpeded. The release ends by saying government's new regulation to restrict fishing licenses to only Belizean nationals is a very positive step and we applaud them for instituting it. On the other hand, imposing regulations on types of gill nets has been tried before without success. The BFF feels strongly that a full ban is needed and we are committed to working with government to make this happen. And while illegal and unregulated fishing in Belize's waters outside of gill nets continues to happen to this day, many fishers, both local and foreign, get away with it. But one Cow Pen Village fisherman didn't. Diogenes Gomez pleaded guilty to charges of illegal entry into a national monument and illegal fishing when he appeared today before Senior Magistrate Tricia Pitts Anderson. He was fined $2,000 for each offense. He was given until April 15th to pay one of the fines and until June 15th to pay the other fine. If he defaults on payment, he will serve 3 months for each fine. Gomez was busted about 2 a.m. on December 4th, fishing in the Half Moon Key Monument, located at the southeast corner of Lighthouse Reef Atoll. A park ranger was on routine patrol in the Half Moon Key Monument when he saw Gomez in a blue canoe fishing. The ranger found 78 conch inshells and 101 unprocessed conch and lobster. We'll take a break now, but when we come back, we'll show you two new fire trucks for San Pedro and special payments for special police. But we'll tell you the big overtime bill for September. Don't go away.
This Friday, the 13th, Mikado is offering a real throat slashing on prices. Come and get a great deal this Friday the 13th. Don't miss our massive Black Friday this weekend, Friday the 13th. All our prices will be peeled to the bones. Come downtown to Mikado at number 37 Albert Street and get awesome deals on all our items this Friday the 13th.
Jason, please let me go. Let me go, please, Jason. I am going. Spare me. I must head to Mikado now for the Friday the 13th sale.
I have slashed the prices at Mikado. Now go take advantage of the low prices this weekend, Friday the 13th. Go now.
Mikado, your textile powerhouse. Centrally located at 37 Albert Street, Belize.
That time of the year when we spread that holiday cheer with our family and friends far and near. This season, make more calls, send more texts, share all your Christmas experiences, because the more you share, the more chances you have to win in Diddy's Grand Christmas Raffle, where the grand prize is an amazing 2020 Wingle 7. Pick up that Christmas device from Digi or sign up for DigiNet and you also qualify. Postpaid customers, you too can spread that Christmas cheer and win. Just ensure that your bill is paid up. With over $60,000 in cash and prizes, there's so many reasons for you to share that Christmas feeling with everyone. The more you share, the more chances you have to win. Drawing date December 24th at 3 p.m. This season, share all the joy with Digi and win.
The Honorable Edmond clear the land and off the air, and thank you, Bash. And this time we come in to Sand Hill on Sunday, December 29th.
Musical entertainment by Boots the Titiman Flores, Harrison Doggy King, Continental Cat,
Punta Queen with her dancers,
Youth Connection Band,
The Singing Policeman, and Ozzy the Clown,
DJs Baba, Rastingi, and DJ Malcolm, free food clear the land style, free buses leaving all villages in Belize Rural North. Just get in touch with your village leaders for transportation information. The party ends with big fireworks, clear the land style. A big thank you from your era representative for Belize Rural North, Honorable Edmond Clear the Land Castro.
It's the Honorable Edmond Clear the Land and off the air, and thank you, Bash. And this time we come in to Sand Hill on Sunday, December 29th.
Let's get together and feel all right.
Give thanks and praise to the Lord, and I will feel all right.
This is Sweet Santa Claus. Or he's a strange man from a mysterious land who's looking to sneak into our home, to smuggle dubious packages after gathering information about us. He breaks into our property while we sleep. And what do we do? Welcome him. Because it doesn't matter how different we may see, if we simply choose to see the good in other people.
Christmas is a season to create wonderful memories with your family and friends.
That's right.
Share more special moments this season with Atlantic Bank. Save time for what matters most by using Go Mobile, Atla Express, Atlantic Online, and your Visa debit card.
Use any of these Bank Your Way services for a chance to win one of 50 amazing Christmas prizes. You can win a 65-inch smart TV, 60-inch smart TV, Samsung 10, Sony PlayStation, gift certificates, and many more fantastic prizes. Atlantic Bank, making your holidays brighter.
See if it makes any sense to you. Butane prices are at an all-time low. That's a good thing, right? Well, not according to the UDP government.
We noted that the LPG suppliers, the importers of LPG, decided to sell below the market price. And it's a price war, if you will. And so we had to institute a floor.
Christmas is a couple weeks away. People cooking, baking, enjoying the lowest butane prices ever. But this government can't give us a break. They have gone to the House to force butane companies to raise their prices.
To ensure that we can put in provisions in that to penalize suppliers who do not respect government control prices.
This government has no love for us. It's time for them to go. Change is coming.
Go-getters. They're DigiFans, and they keep us going. So thanks for all the snaps, videos, likes and shares, uploads and downloads, calls, texts, gaming and creating, teaching and learning. Because you're why we do what we do. Thanks for being a DigiFan.
Digi, always more.
And gala. It's almost gone. Call 614-5541. Pick up Friday, December 13th, West Track Service Station. Support Belize Changing Belize.
Kadile sa Albert Ether lobe.
Ether no mada. Eh na ba santi go lida le gabri. Asa ta lida le skola abro hatia. Afia na lo ni la mege do.
Time out. Wari hali ani gibele habusa rogrigi ya wena mohaya hagamro duniwa irahia. Baro bada, ayano haba hama bisani gu. Demele badugu nile, bide haba lida lerederu niwa hagamredu niwa irahia.
She drunk whenever I got this. Goodness. Oh my gosh, it's the artist.
Being the artist.
The artist.
But you had way more than two drinks tonight, love, which is a legal limit to drive. What about you? Can you drive?
Well, I was drinking soft drink all night, so I can drive her home.
Aw, thanks, Brie. Of course, Tricia, you know I got you. You're my girl.
That's what I like to see. Friends don't let friends drive drunk. Cause you can't replay in a real life stick system. Can't replay in a real life.
Our next story is about police overtime. Well, not overtime because cops don't make that. But during Easter, September celebrations, and December, they do get paid for what's called payment extraneous hours. Basically, it's extra hours the cops work to keep criminals at bay while you celebrate. But tonight there is scrutiny surrounding the police special patrol unit and particularly its commander superintendent of police, Aaron Gamboa. The so-called extraneous payments made to him and his unit for September have been raising eyebrows. In Gamboa's case, as commander, he's claiming 211 extraneous hours in September. That's an average of like 7 extra hours a day, every day, 7 days a week. And for that month, he's getting paid $3,165 extra, which is almost the same as his monthly take-home salary. We have seen sheets with similar extraneous payments for other members of his unit, but his is the highest. Today, the Commissioner of Police said there's no problem with it because the SPU in particular has to work all over the country during those festive months, including working through days off. He added, quote, at the end of the day, security comes with a cost, end quote. For several months now, we've been telling you about the important meeting of the Caribbean Ministers of Trade at the Council for Trade and Economic Development, or COTID for short. It is an important decision-making arm of CARICOM that specifically oversees the Caribbean trade markets. And the major players in Belize's sugar industry were eagerly anticipating that it would take the necessary steps to promote the trade of regionally produced sugar within the Caribbean. Well, a press release from the Sugar Association of Caribbean, of which Belize is a member, says that last month's COTID meeting saw positive developments. The SAC press release says, quote, SAC agreed to accelerate investment to produce higher quantities of quality food-grade sugar, end quote. The release says that Belize and Guyana have already begun significant investment programs to meet the CARICOM demand for sugar. They say that collectively, all the region's producers already produce double the amount of sugar needed to meet CARICOM's needs. But two-thirds of that annual demand is filled with sugar produced by countries outside the region that not only aren't subjected to market tariffs, but actually forces CARICOM producers out of their own market. The release adds, SAC also discussed the continuing importation of brown sugar from outside the region without full application of the common external tariff. This practice has massively diluted the value of the regional market for regional sugar producers. Coated agreed that this practice should stop forthwith. A new monitoring mechanism of sugar flows also agreed at Quoted will enforce the current use of treaty protections moving forward, end quote. They are anticipating that they will be able to sell around 60,000 tons of direct consumption sugar to non-producing countries in CARICOM in 2019 to 2020. If you watch the news with regularity, you will know that San Pedro has seen the most deadly fire disasters in Belize, with multiple persons perishing in house fires over the years. Well, finally, there is some relief. Two fire trucks were donated today by the owners of Casa de la Quivias. At today's ceremony, Brad Campbell and Mark Backen, who represented the donors, officially handed over the two fire trucks to a contingent of government representatives, including NEMO, Minister Edmond Castro, Area Rep Eshules Manuel Heredia Jr., Mayor Daniel Guerrero, Assistant Fire Chief Benisford Matura, and Gladstone Buckner, the officer in charge of Ambergris Key. Well, with these two donated today, plus the other two donated last year by the Rotary Club of Belize and Digi, the hope is that an island's emergency response will be significantly bolstered to deal with future fires. And while San Pedro has two more fire trucks, it's unlikely that they will have a new air carrier anytime soon, and they don't need one. The island is serviced very regularly by Tropicair and Maya, with dozens of flights a day. Some say that the competition isn't sustainable, and there have been rumors for years that the two companies may have to consider a merger. Tropic's CEO says it's not a good idea.
Are the air routes or the airways or the sky in Belize, is this large enough for two major carriers like Tropic and my island?
Oh, I think competition is essential. I think that once you have a monopoly, you're going to go down that road of people never feeling comfortable with you. As long as people have an alternative and you offer them a good service for value, I think we'll be fine. And competition is something that requires that. It'll make us better. It does make us better, and I think it makes our competitor better. I think he has to be sharp. So I think it's the best of all worlds. I just don't believe in monopolies.
Combined, the two airlines have close to two dozen planes, mostly Cessna Caravans. Last week, Tuesday, we told you about 31-year-old Dillion Diamond. The cops say that he's the parolee who tried to rob an off-duty police officer. And tonight, the man who was reportedly his accomplice is out on bail. He's 28-year-old Orlando Salazar, and he was arraigned today before Senior Magistrate Tricia Pitts Anderson. The offense of attempted robbery. He pleaded not guilty to the offense, and he was released on bail of $5,000. He must return to court on February 13th of 2020. As we told you, the incident occurred on December 1st. Police Constable Javier Moroquin reported that he and two other officers were socializing on East College Canal when a man snuck up behind him. This man poked him in the side with an object in an aggressive manner. Moroquin said that when he turned around to face his would-be assailant, this man and his associate ran away. Salazar, who has been identified as the accomplice, got off a murder charge in February of this year. If you are a selfie queen, like many of us are, and I won't call any names, you will know that lighting is everything. Well, it goes beyond lighting in photography. Mexican photographer Esrad Castillo is in Belize offering training for Belizean photographers. He's showing the participants all the camera tips and tricks to capture the best photos. The workshop started this afternoon at the Mexican Institute in Belize City, and here's more.
This is going to be a two-day workshop for Belizean photographers and general people who are interested in the photographic arts to understand a little bit more and to do it in little tricks and maneuvers of the camera to do it in a professional level.
una colección de fotografías que he realizado.
It is a collection of photographs I took in 2012 of Yucatan, a neighboring state. I have collected photographs of important things, not only of tourism, but also of vegetation and nature, as well as archaeological sites. Our country is very rich with archaeological sites.
Muy rica en zonas arqueológicas. Nosotros en el ámbito fotográfico con los compañeros en Mérida nombramos.
We as photographers in Mérida realize that photography is a modern art form because more than 95% of the population in the world has access to a camera. And it is the in thing right now. It is very simple to take a photo or capture a video with a cell phone. And this makes the people interested in photography. And so you as a professional photographer can take great pictures. Because one of the things that the person behind the camera is also the one who captures the photo and transmits what everyone will see. Through social networks, photographers can transmit beautiful things.
El que está detrás de la cámara es el que hace la fotografía, el que transmite lo que...
A special showcase of Castillo's work began at 6 at the Institute. The workshop continues tomorrow afternoon at 1 and ends at 5. The Inter-American Development Bank's Vice President Alexandre Mira de Rosa visited Belize this week to meet with top government officials and members of the private sector. He was here to discuss how the bank's partnership and cooperation with the government and the private sector could be strengthened to ensure the country's continued sustainable development. The IDB Vice President was accompanied by Cassandra Rogers, the IDB country representative, and he paid a courtesy visit to Prime Minister Dean Barrow. The IDB executive also met with Joy Grant, the governor of the Central Bank of Belize, to discuss the current macroeconomic and fiscal conditions in Belize. They also had meetings with key private sector partners to discuss collaboration opportunities. A press release from the bank says, quote, Vice President Rosa signed two technical cooperation grant agreements under the IDB lab with Yakshe Conservation Trust for the project enhancing conservation in Belize's protected areas through disruptive technologies, and with the Development Finance Corporation for the project Green Finance for Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency for MSMEs, totaling US of $924,000. End quote. He then visited the country's only regional sanitary land at mile 24 on the George Price Highway. You'll remember that the nation's garbage disposal process was completely overhauled in 2013 with the opening of this landfill and four transfer stations. The project was funded by the IDB and the OPEC Fund for International Development. The IDB Vice President's visit to Belize is a part of his overseas tour of several IDB member countries. This morning, Minister of Foreign Affairs Wilfred Ellerington received the second and final portion of the Taiwanese contribution to the construction of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs Belmopan headquarters. But how much is ongoing construction costing? Well, that figure, nor the amount of funding provided by the government of Belize, has been made public record. The ministry's Belmopan headquarters, with the phantom price tag, is set to be completed by June of 2020. Table tennis is getting some help from a top international trainer. This week, he's helping sports coordinators in a course being administered at the Mexico Sports Center. We stopped in today.
This activity is part of the Developing National Association program, this ITTF program, to give support for the National Association with more needs in Latin America. And well, Belize was selected to be a part of this program, and we are here as ITTF to boost the table tennis here in Belize with different activity into the 15 days action plan, like educational for coach, promotion through the TV and radio also to promote the table tennis in general, with a workshop with the national coaches, training camp with kids. But the main idea is to promote the table tennis and give support for the National Association to move up to take the National Association for another level. This activity is educational for coaches, no? But in this course participate about 16 sport educational coordinators. This is really great. And I saw a great motivation because for many of them, is it the first time into the contact with the table tennis. And the main of this course is to introduce them for the basic techniques, for the organization of tournament, do the rule of the table tennis in this first stage. And the next stage is they have the mission to promote the table tennis into the school in different departments, in different districts.
The training continues next week, and that's all we have for you for tonight. Thanks for watching with your news. I'm Indira Craig. Remember that you can see a streaming video of this newscast at 7newsbelize.com, brought to you by Digi for the best postpaid plans in the country. Do join us back here tomorrow, and until then, have a great night.